Hello, everyone. My name is Saida Russell, a programmer here at the Burns, and I'd like to welcome you all to tonight's virtual Q&A for the film Mr. Soul, which is screening as part of the series Remix, The Black Experience in Film, Media, and Art. So hopefully you've all been able to watch the film via our virtual marquee, but if you haven't, don't worry, there's still time, and I encourage those of you who haven't seen it yet to seek it out. So this series has been on hiatus for over 6 months, and I'm very excited to be able to relaunch with this specific film and this event. Mr. Soul is something I've been wanting to screen at the Burns and in Remix for some time, because apart from being just a wildly fascinating historical record, the film really speaks to the mission of Remix and to the heart of this series, which is to both celebrate the breadth and nuance of the Black lived experience, and to acknowledge the immense contributions of Black artists and filmmakers. In the face of continued hostility and continued violence against Black people, it's increasingly important to carve out spaces where Black life and Black culture can be fully explored and celebrated. So I hope you'll continue to engage with and to support this series as it moves forward. All of that being said, I would like to quickly introduce our esteemed guests for tonight. First, we have the director of Mr. Soul, Melissa Haizlip. Melissa is an award-winning filmmaker whose work responds to pressing social issues at the intersection of racial justice, social justice, activism, and representation. Melissa has been awarded grants at the Ford Foundation, National Endowment for the Arts, Black Public Media, Firelight Media, and ITVS. And she is currently producing a docuseries on women in hip hop. Joining Melissa in conversation is JBFC Chairman Emeritus Hugh Price. Hugh is an activist, philanthropist, and former president of the National Urban League, where he established the Institute for Opportunity and Equality. He has also published several books, including most recently, This African American Life. I'm so excited to have both of them joining us tonight. And I want to thank you all again for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed the discussion.
Thank you so much, Saida. I want to join you in welcoming everyone to this webinar, and it's especially exciting to welcome Melissa Haizlip, who is an extraordinary filmmaker. Melissa conceived, wrote, produced, and directed Mr. Soul, and I just want to say to you, Melissa, that I tried to prepare for this interview, did a lot of research, watched the thing, but the only thing I couldn't get my hands on was my afro from back in the day. I looked in the closet and it was long gone. So anyway, I can't add that to the repertoire. To quote an old saying, the talent did not fall far from the tree. Melissa's late father, Dr. Harold Haizlip, who has a major role in Mr. Soul, the movie, was a distinguished educator and former commissioner of education for the U.S. Virgin Islands. Her mother, Shirley Taylor Haizlip, is a best-selling author whose first book was a huge success. That book is titled The Sweeter the Juice. And interestingly enough, the theme of The Sweeter the Juice is very similar to a current best-selling novel which folks may have heard of, namely The Vanishing Half. Only Shirley Taylor Haizlip's book is rooted in reality. It's the story of her mother's search for her long-lost aunt who had vanished into the white world, and who was rediscovered by Shirley. The book contains family photos for readers who are curious what African Americans who looked like, who were able to pass, what they looked like and how they got away with it. Melissa had a successful dancing career in musical theater. She was in Jelly's Last Jam, a great musical on Broadway, and she also performed in The Lion King in Los Angeles. Let me open up by asking Melissa, when did you know intellectually or emotionally that it was time to retire from dance, or did you just feel it in your bones and in your knees?
Well, thank you for that lovely introduction, and thank you also to Saida and to Jesse and to everyone at the Jacob Burns Film Center. We're so honored to be here, and thank you, Hugh, for moderating tonight. Very special.
My pleasure. Indeed.
I knew at some point that I wanted to tell a larger story. And I had enjoyed a really robust career in musical theater and dance, drama, arts, all the arts really. But I knew that I wanted to put that expertise into actually crafting something visual, and that we were becoming more and more a visual society. And with the onset of all the digital technology, I realized there's so many stories that need to be told by us, for us especially. And I wanted to start with this story in particular of Ellis Haizlip, because again, he had done such an incredible thing on television, which is a visual medium, but we have advanced so far that it felt like it needed to be worked out on film. I thought at first I should write a book, but then someone else got to that first, which is wonderful. Gail Wald, a professor, George Washington University, wrote a beautiful book called It's Been Beautiful, Soul and Black Power Television. Mm. So once I realized that the book had been done, and I realized that there was a real need to see this in a modern day context, to understand not only how far we've come, but how far we have yet to go in terms of diversity, inclusion in television, and in the media, namely. So I just decided, I picked this rather ambitious project, but I knew that it was a story that I wanted to make visible, just as Ellis Haizlip had made Black culture visible on television.
How on earth did you make the leap from a professional dancer to an award-winning filmmaker with your very first film? There are a lot of folks in the audience who probably would like to be filmmakers, or they have children who want to be filmmakers, and everybody says you got to go to film school, blah, 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 blah. And you made the jump from stage to award-winning documentary. How did you pull that off?
Well, I always knew that I loved being in front of the camera because I had acted before. I understood the language of cinema. I'd always been a big fan of cinema, especially. And I knew that this was a really great opportunity if I could somehow, I already had this idea of how to tell a story. Storytelling comes in naturally to you and all of us in the family. But I knew that the medium was much more dynamic in terms of, for me, the excitement of working in film. And I'd worked on a lot of other films and smaller films. I did some shorts and I did a lot of art films. And I moved to Los Angeles and I got a job at AFI and worked in development. So I really immersed myself in filmmaking.
Right.
And I just eventually started to become a fellow in many programs that were about encouraging emerging, people of color, basically. When you say emerging, that's what that means, artists to follow their dreams. And so I worked, I had many different fellowships and I learned as I went along in these fellowships about filmmaking and immersed myself with other filmmakers and worked on other projects. So in Los Angeles, I was a fellow there at Film Independent. They have a program called Project Involve, and also with the Producers Guild of America, the diversity group, and also through Stanley Nelson has a wonderful doc lab called Firelight Media Doc Lab. Then I became a fellow at National Black Programming Consortium. I was sort of their artist in residence. They go by Black Public Media now. So I was constantly immersing myself in the genre, but also building community as I made my smaller films and made my way up. I worked on everybody's project. I volunteered for everything. I was a grip. I was an AD. I was a casting person. Then I became a casting director. Then I became an associate director. And then eventually I realized it was time to helm my own project, as long as I surrounded myself with the right team and picked a really strong board of academic advisors, of which you are a member, and tried to imbue all the projects that I was planning to do with this sort of notion of it takes a village, because it really always does. It is a communal effort.
Roughly how long was that process of reinvention before you took on your first big film, Mr. Soul?
Well, the process is ongoing, I'd like to say.
I know, but just from the time you left the stage to the time that you started on Mr. Soul, how long?
That was about 10 years, I think.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's a real investment, huge investment.
Yeah.
Let me ask you about your experience on stage. Not roles or anything like that, but as a Broadway dancer, you performed under the direction of one of the great stage directors, George Wolfe. Mm-hmm. Did that experience impact your approach to filmmaking? Was there anything about storytelling on stage that was that informed storytelling and documentary film?
I think so. And George C. Wolfe is a visionary, and to be able to be in that original cast was just so it just expanded my mind infinitely, because I'd never worked with a cast that was that spectacular, from Gregory Hines to Ben Vereen and a spectacular, incredible team, both on stage and off. And just seeing how the culture was mined and how it was reimagined, trying to break stereotypes and create a new mode and a new modality almost for theater. Because at the same time, he had also been involved in Angels in America.
Right.
And so we were rehearsing together at the same time, and we're equally impressed by each other and the experiences we were going through. And that really
was this Angels in America on stage or Angels in America for television?
On stage.
On stage. Okay.
Yeah, he directed the very first one. Yeah.
Okay.
And Joe Montella was in it, you know, before that he became the director as well. Right. So yeah, that was a remarkable time, almost like an incubation. Right. And to see that kind of great mind and the type of people that he had to bring together, whether it was Jules Fisher in lighting or Theoni Aldridge, who was like the most extraordinary, she's passed now and joined the ancestors, but most extraordinary costume designer, all the elements had to come together. And that's what intrigued me. And in fact, I still want to produce Broadway shows now. I think it would be fantastic because I understand that broader vision for the project, and I'd love pulling people together to make it work and making sure it's in the right hands. It's sort of like a custodian, much in the way, very similar to what Ellis did. Of course, these are big shoes to fill, so I'm not comparing myself. But I understand that sort of curation, how would I say that?
Curatorial.
Curatorial, thank you. Yeah. Curatorial nature that he had and his approach to culture, because he really was curating the culture.
Now, Mr. Soul took about 10 years to make. Why, I gather, or at least to produce and get in front of viewers across the country, why did it take so long? And did you ever give up hope? And what fueled your determination to keep going?
I always knew this was an important story to tell. And I knew that it was, that so many people were relying on this film to be done well. This, not only the stakeholders of the story, the people who have the lived experience, the artists, the activists, the historians who were involved and who lived through this moment, this pivotal moment of time, but also that this type of story needed to be told. And it was incumbent upon me to not only get it right, but to situate it historically and to validate almost historically the work of Ellis Haizlip and to situate the Soul archive in, rightfully so, in the canon of significant and historic television, late night television shows in the annals of late night television. That was really very important to me, as I saw so many of our elder statesmen of and the African-American icons in the 20th century leaving us. I realized that this one particular moment, this sort of new Harlem Renaissance for that generation, had not had their stories told or hadn't had a chance to tell them in the context of that beginning. And I thought, well, who better to tell the story than I, because I knew I have this connection with Ellis. I was very close to him, but I also, I loved this show and I loved what it represented. And I knew that the story had to be, it had to be created with love. It had to have that intentionality behind it, not just intellectually and academically, but and historically, and the accuracy of all of those three, but it needed to be guided by love.
Some great filmmakers, documentarians, we know Ken Burns and Stanley Nelson, others, I don't want to say they have money raining down on them, but it isn't the struggle. But you, did you really have to hustle for the money that you, I don't mean hustle in any pejorative sense, but did you really have to work hard, and were there droughts? And how do you just realistically get through that longest stretch of having to make a film and keep the dream alive?
Yeah, and that's kind of the second half of your question, I just realized, is that part of the time that it took to actually get to this moment where the film is completed and we're sharing it, streaming it nationwide, is because we decided, and it may not have been the best decision, but I still think it was appropriate. We decided that the film would be funded entirely by grants. We felt that we wanted to match the pedigree or the naissance of Soul, the fact that Soul had been born of a certain period, but it also was made by funded by grants of public funding. I thought that that was really important, that this film be for us, by us, and to be funded by the National Endowment for the Arts, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and of course, Ford Foundation, since Ford Foundation funded the original Soul series back in 1968.
Right.
So that sort of set us on a path of writing grants, being in a grant cycle, and being rejected more often than being rewarded, or awarded, I should say. And you can't always control that. It's a very limited pool of money, and yet the amount of filmmakers who need that money is growing exponentially. What was different about our show, our film, was that we were never attached to anything. We were literally independent filmmakers, DIY as they call it. We didn't have a secured broadcast that was guaranteed yet. We weren't part of a series, in other words, like great performances or American Masters or
American Experience or anything like that.
And we also weren't based on like a Pulitzer Prize winning historical novel. Everything was being created and nobody knew who I was. And so that's a little bit of a drawback. So it was really important to surround our team with, you know, incredible professionals with great track records, and so that we could sort of bring a legitimacy to the project, but also to involve everyone and make it feel like it was our story that we were telling. So that took longer, much longer than we expected. But in a way, the timing of it is just perfect.
Oh yeah, it couldn't be better.
We were hoping that it would be done in time for the 50th anniversary of Soul, and luckily that did happen.
Yeah, well, to have it hit right now in the middle of everything that's going on is amazing. Let's talk about the context for the program back in the day. It debuted in 1968 during a very turbulent time in American history. I remember well because I came of age as a young professional. At the time, I was a legal services lawyer in New Haven and very much an activist and into the Black Power movement. There were urban uprisings, AKA riots. There was a transition up north from nonviolent civil rights protests to very aggressive, fiery Black Power advocacy. There were anti-war protests. 1968, Martin Luther King was assassinated. Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. LBJ withdrew from running for president. So America was discombobulated in 1968, and it was unsure where the turbulence was coming from, and it wasn't sure what the way forward was. How would you characterize the African-American experience and presence and coverage in the media in 1968 or 67 on the eve of, and when Ellis was conceiving of Soul? What was the environment like?
The environment was certainly responding to the time, but unfortunately and historically, the media had been weaponized against the humanity of African-Americans. And that was divisive, and it really created stereotypes. There was a criminalization of Black people that was prevalent. The only thing you saw on television was negative stereotypes. What was associated with people of color would be this sort of national unrest, even though people were responding in the only way they could to the, as you say, the assassination of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. And so here you have people pushing back against the structures, trying to find a way to have their voices heard. But regardless, it was constant negativity in the news. All you saw was riots, poverty, you know, the garbage not being picked up in Harlem. And that was not the totality of the Black experience. So something needed to interrupt that narrative. And that was what made this sort of ripe moment for Soul to appear, to sort of reclaim this the perception of African-American culture.
Right. Let's talk about the genius of Ellis Haizlip. I mean, into this environment strode a very unlikely television personality, to say the least. In many respects, he was the antithesis of a TV talk show host. He was cerebral, which is maybe nothing unusual about that, but he was also a very reticent personality, and he did not perform the role of being a host. But he was a very unobtrusive host, yet he was the fulcrum of the entire show. How did he get away with serving as host on this show? And was that his original intention?
The irony is, I think of Ellis as being a reluctant host.
Right.
He was not the original host, and we sort of take you through that in the beginning of the film, and we sort of establish him as a fish out of water, someone who's a little uncomfortable, a little reluctant. And also, and you can certainly attest to this, that was a moment where we were really trying to redefine ourselves as African Americans on the heels of the civil rights movement during this tumultuous time, coming through Jim Crow. And so there weren't a lot of options and there weren't a lot of images that spoke to our excellence. And so it almost had to be validated by some, the idea of a host or someone who could speak to this Black experience. It was expected that that person would be a very erudite, triple PhD, inscrutable, highly educated academic.
Like your father.
And also that was set up by, of course, you remember the whole experiment with the dolls.
Right.
What was good, what was bad, and this notion that you had to be buttoned up and presentable, and that sort of argument about what is allowable thought and representation of the proper African American that is the antithesis of what they're seeing in the news. So they felt beholden to that, especially they, meaning the programmers and the people in charge of the show. So Ellis went about trying to find an appropriate host, and he chose Alvin Poussant, who of course becomes later on the arbiter of Black culture and being working very closely on the Cosby Show as an advisor on all things Black. But even though he was a psychiatrist from Harvard, he had all the right credentials, that wasn't the vibe that Ellis wanted. He wanted someone who could sort of navigate both worlds. He could be a person who would be down with the street, but also know what was happening with the artist, and also very responsible and could speak to a myriad of individuals. And I think that Ellis Haizlip knew that he really wasn't meant to be the host. After my father became the host, he was very good, but he only lasted one or two shows because he was also a headmaster of the New Lincoln School, which was a very progressive private school, but you know, balancing those two jobs was a little bit difficult. And so I guess Ellis realized that he couldn't find anyone else who would have the same aesthetic and who could, you know, manage both of those worlds and also bring in all these elements and have their finger on the pulse of what's happening in the community and in the arts. So he just decided to do it himself. And what's fun, the way we set it up in the film is we show him, allow you to take that journey with him as he becomes kind of the ultimate host, because he certainly wasn't in the beginning.
Ellis was an openly gay man in an unforgiving, homophobic environment. How did his sexuality and his openness about who he was impact his vision for soul?
I think this is very significant. And just to contextualize, we have to remember that this was before Stonewall. And
so
it was a very homophobic time in our nation, even within our own culture. And so Ellis, who was openly gay and proud, but of course we have to remember he didn't wear his gender politics, no one really on their sleeve at that time. That was not an appropriate thing at the time for those who make judgments as such. I think it's appropriate, but that's another story. So for Ellis, I think that may have added to his reluctance to being the host, is that he didn't want his persona or his sexuality to get in the way of people who wouldn't accept him when he had such a message to bring. I think he balanced, and what he did was he was a little seditious in a way, in that he would create a platform with Soul that was not only a vehicle for African-American artistry, but a platform for political expression and the fight for social justice. And that was not the trifecta we knew. And certainly we didn't expect him to have any other agendas, but just by being gay, by being queer and holding court and being able to be successful, that in itself was revolutionary. And he had many artists on the show that we may not have known were gay or who were not out at the time.
Right.
And just by putting that agenda forward, that was also pushing the culture forward and demanding to be seen and accepted.
Another thing that was revolutionary about his approach is that women played major, major roles on the production team. It may have been the predominant production team. How did that impact the design and curatorial choices that were made for the program?
I think Ellis always knew that there were interesting Black women doing interesting things. Now, it's interesting, what is interesting is that he was a feminist, especially if you think about it now. He was always pushing forward the opportunities for Black women who were not receiving that type of treatment at the time. They weren't part of, you know, the, it was, yes, we had the women's liberation movement, but there was no Black women's liberation within that movement. And I don't know if this was deliberate or not, but I suspect it was. And I, there was always an intentionality around everything that he did. The idea that the Black woman and her contributions to the arts, the culture, the history, that needed to be celebrated. And so for him to empower so many women at a time when there were no Black women at all on television in producer roles, so he was able to give two women that that wonderful opportunity, Anna Maria Horsford, and she became a famous actress, of course, and another woman, Alice LaBrie, who was also Alice Hill Jackson at the time and married to Hal Jackson, the radio personality at the time. And he also just empowered women to be out front. He asked Nikki Giovanni to host a show. You wouldn't see Black women hosting shows at all. Mm-hmm. That just did not happen.
Much less a poet.
And so these were, he was constantly breaking the expectations while also creating an expansiveness for Black culture on television. And part of that was by loving Black women and recognizing that they have always been behind, in front of, and especially a part of these movements. Let, you know, not just the civil rights movement, but all of the movements. There's always been Black women doing really important things.
I've heard it said of him that his approach was sort of unfiltered, uncompromising depiction of Blackness, and he wasn't there to entertain, wasn't seeking validation. This was a show for Black folk, by Black folk, about Black folk. Can you elaborate on that philosophy?
I think you probably remember this term because it was very popular back in the day, is that Ellis was a race man. And at the time, that is not to be confused with racist. It's a completely different definition. But this idea of doing something for the race, uplifting the race, creating opportunity for the race, coming from a world and a very segregated world in Washington, D.C., which was actually nourishing to him in a beautiful environment, he knew that he could find strength in that. And he wanted to create more opportunities for the beauty of the Black expression to exist.
Plus, he was a graduate of Howard University.
Exactly. And he went to Dunbar High School. So that sort of had been instilled in him, this Black pride, Black love, Black sister and brotherhood. It wasn't a reaction to or asking permission for him to exist. It was instead saying, this is who we are. Our Blackness is beautiful. It's undiluted. It's revolutionary. But it's also unapologetic because this is just who we are, and we're going to share this with you, and we invite you to share in the experience. And so that became a universal experience when the country was divided at the time. So you wouldn't necessarily have Black people in your living room in 1968.
Right.
So that he had the audacity to say, allow us to invite you to experience this plethora of culture in a way that wasn't threatening because it was on television. That was really, really remarkable. And I think
For folks who may not know who are watching, mm-hmm. I mean, Howard University, you've probably heard of, is a great historically Black college university. Dunbar High School was a remarkable high school. It was a segregated high school. My father went there, and many, many other Black folks in DC. But many of the faculty members had PhDs. Mm-hmm. And they taught there because there was no other place to teach.
Nice.
So it was an incredibly intellectually robust place, and the products of Dunbar is extraordinary, and Ellis is one of the most illustrious products of Dunbar. So I'm sorry I interrupted you, but I had to.
Oh no, that you're absolutely right, and that pride that had been instilled became very evident in his insistence upon presenting that fullness, that richness, and not just the beauty and the art, dancing, singing, and the performative aspects of the culture, but also the critical thought in the culture, right. The dissent right. of the culture, right. to present diametrically opposed views of the culture. He approached it as a wholesome experience and a fulsome one.
Right.
And that's really remarkable, because that really was the only agenda. It wasn't really a political agenda, and it wasn't, when you say unapologetic, it was simply because he was never asking permission
right.
to share
right.
what he already knew to be innately
right.
true.
Right.
Yeah.
We've talked about Ellis's vision for Soul. What was your vision for Mr. Soul?
Oh my goodness. Well, first, it was a difficult vision because I didn't know how we were going to do it all in an hour and a half. When you look at the scope of this extraordinary show, it's 130 episodes. So that's 130 complete hours of without interruption, without any commercial, of beautiful, extraordinary, exquisite footage of some of the greatest African-American icons of the 20th century in their prime. So that was really daunting when I first started the cast. And I said, whoops, maybe I bit off more than I could chew. But I was also interested to see how that would intersect with Ellis Haizlip's story, and could we create something that was different? I think the impetus behind the style that you see and the aesthetic choices that we made is that we knew that this show was spectacular, that it was innovative for its time, that it was beautiful and unusual and groundbreaking and pioneering. So we thought, well, how can we earn the right to use that footage? We're gonna have to make something that is commensurate, that is equally as beautiful for our time, that is innovative in the shooting style, in the technology, in the way that we weave together these stories, the biography of the show and the biography of the man. So the mandate to do something that was worthy of this was what kept us on our toes and kept us honest as well. Mm. And in order to make sure that the story we were telling could encompass three storylines, the story of Soul, the story of Ellis Haizlip, and the story of the zeitgeist of what was happening in America, what was happening in the nation that would have created an opportunity for Soul. And then our job was to take those three storylines and collapse them into one, and to find the salient moments of all three. And so that was the jigsaw puzzle, the Tetris, if you will, is how everything had to earn its way into the story. So nothing was extraneous, nothing was gratuitous. And that's how we made our choices about what to show, what not to show, how much to show. And there were some financial choices made as well. It's expensive. It's a very rights-intensive show, because you're dealing with some of the most extraordinary artists, and their catalogs are quite pricey when it comes to licensing. So there were a lot of things to consider. We put our art and our desire and our story first, though. Yeah. And then we tried to match that up with the timing, the budget, and the overall story that we were trying to tell.
Well, there certainly was no shortage of material to work with. That's an understatement.
No,
there, the documentary has so many really show-stopping moments. I mean, Die Niggers by the Last Poets, and you got to get past people who are sort of sensitive about language, got to get past that. The message is very, very powerful. Mm-hmm. Young Al Green in Live in Studio, just extraordinary. The interview between Ellis and Minister Farrakhan is one for the ages. But maybe the most memorable segment for me was the Nikki Giovanni interviewing James Bond, James Baldwin. What was the backstory of that interview? How did
this particular episode is actually a two-part episode, because it was a two-hour conversation between James Baldwin and Nikki Giovanni. The idea was Nikki Giovanni had been working very closely with Ellis. She was his muse in a way, and he helped produce some of the seminal work that she was doing, combining gospel music with her really percussive poetry, and this beautiful album called Truth Is On Its Way, and really nurturing her spoken word as it was just beginning to take flight. And so what she wanted to do in response was talk to James Baldwin, and Ella said, well, I know James Baldwin, he's a good friend. They had actually worked together, and Ellis Haizlip actually produced the very first version of the Amen Corner in international tour in 1965. So they go way back. And so she kind of said, well, you owe me, because I've been so hard with you. So he said, sure, well, what do you want to do? You want to have a conversation with Jimmy? She said, I'd love to talk to Jimmy.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. And that was her, not only her mentor in a way, but her idol. And there was about 20-year difference between the two of them. So this is 1971. James Baldwin was living in France. You know, he was sort of an expat at the time in St. Paul de Vence because he was unhappy with what was happening in America and the race relations. So the idea was, well, how can we get to you? And he agreed to meet halfway. So they chose London. Now, I have done so much research to try to figure out how they were able to go to London in 1971 with a crew and create the most extraordinary episode you've ever seen. It really is the high watermark of the season because you have two of the most extraordinary African-American icons of the literary canon, and they're talking about the Black experience. Then they're sometimes they take on these roles of the Black man and the Black woman and the relationship, but it's so real and it's so visceral, and I think it's really very magical. I could have made a whole film about that.
I'm sure. Yeah.
It is 2 hours long. It is pure gold.
And well, you've whetted our appetites. Where can we see it today?
You can see it, actually. There's a number of places that are showing the soul episodes in their entirety. Mm-hmm. The first place I'd suggest, if anyone's a PBS subscriber, you already have something called PBS Passport, and you can go on there and type in the search for soul, and you'll have about 20 episodes on there. If you're online and you are an Amazon Prime member, you can also search on Amazon Prime and watch it there. There are about 24 episodes there. And also on just regular YouTube, you can type it, it'll come up. There's also a really cool site called shoutfactorytv.com. And they have a lot of like nostalgia programming.
Really, so you can track down the Giovanni Baldwin interview specifically on one of those sources.
Yes, both episodes are there.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about Life After Soul. I know that it lost its funding in 1973. Your father said that Soul was undiluted and in your face, and that was its strength as well as its undoing.
Yeah.
Was Ellis crushed by the cancellation? Was he resigned? Was he liberated? How did he feel about losing his firstborn?
I think he was crushed, but I also think he wasn't defeated. I think that's important to point out. One of my favorite lines from the film was sent to him in a telegram, for those of us who are old enough to remember what a telegram is. It was a telegram from Patti LaBelle, and the line read as an encouragement for him on his last episode. Although it's over, it's not the end. Black seeds keep on growing. Right. And that the last part, black seeds keep on growing, is actually a lyric from a song by the main ingredient. But it really sums up this experience that he had. I believe he knew that it was only the beginning of this conversation, but that he was unwilling to compromise his show. And he knew that if it couldn't be accepted and valued for what it was, that maybe it was just not the right time. And even though he was a drum soldier for civil rights and Black power and freedom of expression and inclusion, diversity, his fight had been well fought. And he wanted to end on a high note. I know that he was heartbroken, but I also know that he was not resigned, but determined to move on and hope, in hopes that at some point this moment in time would be recognized.
You've said that you hope the documentary would stimulate a dialogue about whether soul is needed today, and if so, what form would that take? And let's segue to that dialogue, and I spent a few minutes on it. And I also would invite anyone who's watching, if you've got thoughts about what version of soul you'd like to see today, please feel free to call and weigh in. Are the conditions that made soul necessary in 1968 still applicable today?
Well, they're very, especially right now, we are on the eve of a great racial reckoning. And I really feel that we're starting to have conversations in this country about where we want the country to go moving forward. And when you look at this notion of what Ellis Haizlip represented, what he brought to the fore, this idea of diversity and inclusion, freedom of expression, and how we might get there. This is what's important. These are the discussions that we need to have in the midst of this inflection point we have found ourselves in. So it's also important to have Black leadership in media, which is what Ellis Haizlip represented. And to look back at this now, it really speaks to what is necessary in order for us to move forward. And I'd be very interested to see how others weigh in on this. But it's a reminder, because not only was Ellis Haizlip a champion for African-American culture, but this story that we're telling, his story and the story of our nation, is the type of story that we need to tell now more than ever, and especially by us, for us, because authorship and authorship is another question entirely, but it's very significant.
The point about the importance of telling our story reminds me, and I don't mean to get political, but President Trump has proposed revamping how American history is taught, and he wants to teach patriotism and exceptionalism, and he's actually proposed defunding schools that teach the New York Times 1619 project, which places slavery at the heart of American history, politics, and economy. And the way I read that is it's a direct threat to marginalized Black reality and contributions, the telling of the story of the devastation and legacy of slavery. Mm-hmm. I mean, if everything felt retrograde, that is a proposal. So in many respects, soul in the beginning was about telling that story. And it feels as though we've got to double down on telling that story with gusto. What would a modern clone of soul look like in your view? If you were on the drawing board and could say, this is what I dream based on what I know and what I've seen, What would be the basic elements of a modern clone of soul, if there would be such a thing?
Oh, I think there should be, there could be, and there are a lot of discussions happening around it now, which is very exciting.
Okay.
Not necessarily revisiting soul and trying to replicate it, because as you said, it really was a product of its time. But what it speaks to and what it pushes back against is still relevant. And certainly with the revolution that's taking place now, and how we are pushing back against and reframing the narrative of the contribution of Blacks in this country and demanding that that be more egalitarian. I think that a soul, a modern day soul, would be on a different kind of platform that wasn't necessarily beholden to the rules and regulations of, say, network programming. Mm-hmm. It has to be independent, for sure, because there are many voices out there now that are taking up the mantle and speaking to the revolution, but they tend to be independent, whether it's artists who are sort of post-genre and creating their art without restriction or dropping music on Spotify and then changing it, deleting it, and starting over. There's this sense that artists can, as they did then, can push the culture forward, but it has to be independent. And I'm very excited because I think, and especially if Ellis were here, I think he'd be thrilled by what's happening in the digital space, in the virtual space, and how we have so much more authorship now. That's very important.
But how does it, I mean, I'm old school. How does it aggregate? I want to go one place to find it. I don't want to have to shop around to a lot. I mean, what is the guidebook to where all this extraordinary material is, mm-hmm. as opposed to trying to shop around and just get utterly lost and confused in social media world?
Yeah, that was a hard question to answer, because I almost feel like that the place is the internet, but you can get lost in so many rabbit holes on the internet.
Right.
And there are a lot of agendas on the internet that we can't always control, especially the people that are, you know, and the bots that are getting and changing popular opinion now. But I do think that that authorship does come from that freedom that's not attached to it, because people can create their own sites, their own content, they can edit on their own. And so the restrictions and having to answer to a larger authority are pretty much lifted now.
Okay. Yeah. I want to close, but I just want to make one point. I got a little note that my cousins in St. Croix are watching, and Troy D. Shabir, and I know you grew up in St. Croix, so give all of our
shout out to the Virgin Islands.
Right. What, in your judgment, is the legacy of the original soul?
I think the legacy of soul is that there needs to be more place where Black excellence can exist, that Black excellence has always existed, that Black has always been beautiful, and that as long as we know that, we can move forward, that the arts are healing, and that we have established, and soul has certainly established, that there is a tremendous contribution to the arts that Black people have made and will continue to make, and that the universality of the way that has emanated into the culture diasporically and beyond, it's everywhere. And as Felipe Luciano says in the film, Ellis Haizlip knew that Black culture was world culture, or is world culture.
Right.
It led, it didn't pull. And I love this idea that we are so much greater than we know, and that Black seeds keep on going. And so the legacy of soul is that we know, especially in media, very easily we can see that Ellis Haizlip paved the way for many of the late night hosts and the variety shows and the this idea of freedom and cultural expression and multi platforms for artists. He did that. And so we are all we're all standing on the shoulders of giants in many ways, but I think what we owe to a debt to soul for creating this extraordinary opportunity for Black culture to exist and not to have to be defined or ascribed value through another lens.
Before turning it over to any questions we may have from folks who have tuned in, let me ask what you hope will be the legacy of Mr. Soul, the documentary.
Oh, wow. You know, I see Mr. Soul as an extraordinary gift. I like to think of it as a love letter to Black culture, a love letter to Black history. And of course, it's upholding my family legacy, but it's really the legacy of all of us, because Black history is American history, and Black history is now. We are seeing that right now as we're fighting for equality, just as we did in 1968, and with the violence and all the things that we're fighting against. I don't want to get too political, but just to be reaffirmed that there is an innate beauty and importance and significance to the culture. And that if we can keep that in our sights, it will lead the way. And art is healing. I really feel that. And I think that Ellis Haizlip was curating art and curating Black art and Black joy.
Right.
And that those things are really important now more than ever.
Right.
And I'm hoping that the film will inspire people to remember that, and that it will be uplifting, especially during these very dark and challenging times.
Right.
We've chosen to put it in a virtual cinema space and in a way that seems appropriate, because everything is virtual now. And I think Ellis would love that we were doing something of the time, you know, just as he did, trying to come up with a new way to reach people and to bring community together as we are all spread apart and social distancing, to look back on this and remember be reminded of our greatness.
Before we open it up for questions, let me just one mention that we got a note that Leslie Demas, who was one of the original staff members, is watching. And my hope for the legacy is, and I don't have a vote, but I'm really pulling for you to get an Academy Award nomination and an Oscar. So if anybody watching has a vote, please do the right thing. Let's open it up now to any questions that we may have from folks who have tuned in. Jesse, let me turn it back to you.
Absolutely, guys, and a really great and fascinating conversation. Our first question comes from Cheryl Duvall. Public media, like many fields, in the midst of a long overdue discussion about limitations regarding race and representation, staffing, and perceived audience. One of the many things I love about this documentary is that it suggests what non-commercial media could be if it only made the effort. Would either of you care to comment on the way Mr. Soul speaks to the present state of public TV and radio?
Well, let me just comment briefly on that. Soul was in a fight for its life back in the early 70s. Richard Nixon was very hostile, President Nixon was very hostile to public broadcasting. In particular, as you saw from the tapes of him speaking, very hostile to Black programming and particularly to what he perceived to be Black radical programming. And frankly, PBS had to make a choice about whether it as an industry would survive, and if so, what sacrifice would have to be made. And Soul was sacrificed at the altar and in order for the enterprise to survive. And that reveals the vulnerability of a program like this having to rely on government funding in order to exist because of the political vulnerabilities that are involved. So I think to Melissa's point about new platforms, social media, there has to be an independence for an enterprise like this in order for it to breathe as fully as it needs to breathe intellectually. It's quite a story. There are articles, the book has been written about it and there are articles about it. It was quite a nasty battle. And actually, it was funny. I remember years ago watching television, public television from a distance, and whenever the battles would begin, PBS would roll out Big Bird as the major on-air defender of public television. But Soul and Ellis and the Black political community did not have the same clout, so it could not prevail in those battles, and it was basically thrown under the bus.
Yeah, and ironically, I like to think that with a film like this, and I'm happy to announce, although I can't say when, we will have a public television broadcast coming up next year. So we'll be, stay tuned, we'll be telling you when exactly within the coming month. So Soul will have another homecoming, and the film will be seen on PBS, which is really exciting because that's where it belongs. And ironically, I really feel like this film puts the public back in public television, because we have, the television has sort of skewed away from serving all of the people and all of the audiences. Of course, you can get your media from anywhere now. There's billions of places, and most people aren't really watching TV. They're sort of cutting the cord, as they say, and getting their content on their apps or their smart TVs or their phones, their devices. But if there is supposed to be something that is for the people, by the people, this film can speak to that. Ironically, it really is an anniversary, if you think about it, because it shows that PBS was, you could consider to be the incubator of freedom of expression and diversity and inclusion. But I think a lot has changed since that. And certainly sometimes the mandate behind the funding changes and not necessarily the timing and the programming changes. But what the funding is for changes. And so that also had a little part, or rather large part, in the demise of Soul as well. Because they had new initiatives for the funding, and it didn't really suit what was considered to be very controversial and radical thought, especially radical Black thought, which was rather controversial. So the idea of attaching public funding to that was part of the problem.
Well, I think, as I recall, Bill Moyers caused some indigestion as well back in the day. So it was, he had a fledgling public broadcasting enterprise and public funding, and And there was some animus among some politicians. It was a tough combination. Mm-hmm. Are there any other questions from folks?
Yes. Our next question actually comes from an anonymous attendee. While Ellis didn't fight to save Seoul, was there ever a battle to preserve its funding and protect it from extinction? If so, who waged it, and why do you think the rescue effort didn't succeed?
Oh, that's like a three-part question. Okay.
Yeah.
I will say that, yes, what many people don't know is that Ellis had to find funding for Seoul after the first year. It was threatened to end after the first year. So Seoul was never guaranteed year after year after year, like many shows are. There was no guarantee after the first season that there would be a second, and none after the second that there would be a third. So it's a little bit of a miracle that the show survived for the 5 years that it did. And what sometimes that's attributed to these large foundations will give you the money to start the show, but then they sort of push you off on your own and say, okay, now you're on your own and you have to fundraise on your own, which was very hard to do. So that had a lot to do with why it was difficult to find funding year after year. In terms of the second half of that question, who waged the wars? Well, in the end, let's say the last season, when it became clear that the funding initiatives had changed and that the CPB would no longer be supporting the series, Ellis Haizlip actually turned to the people and started a very large letter writing campaign, which we think is somewhat, you know, arcane, but it actually was the direct way to get to the people. And he received thousands of letters, which would be the equivalent of like hundreds of thousands of emails today. And he waged a war by reaching out to community members. I know the National Urban League was part. He reached out to all of the people that he sort of represented, whether it was the student unions and a lot of groups that really felt like this was their voice. I know that sounds a little vague, but there were a lot of community groups that were really pushing. But what ended up happening was it wasn't enough. And once the funding actually dissolved, there was no way to start from scratch with that level of funding again. And it was clear that the initiatives were changing. And one thing that we didn't really discuss in the film was that they had asked Ellis to integrate the show, which was going to change the show entirely. And he did not want to change his vision.
They felt that
we didn't need a show like Seoul. We didn't need Black radical thought anymore. That racism had ended and that we were all assimilating. And yes, there was a move towards assimilation. There's certainly a move towards, you know, lighter fare on television, Sanford and Son and Good Times. And of course you have just this notion that we want to be part of the mainstream, not separate from the mainstream. Right. And Ellis was still pushing the radical Black agenda and the Black pride agenda. And so when he didn't, you know, accept the request to dilute the show, if you will, he really felt that this was one of two Black shows, and he was already integrating the network. Well, PBS is not a network, but the system of shows, the system of stations, rather. And he felt, we are already doing that. Why should I have to dilute my show and my vision? So he wanted to go out on top without sacrificing or sabotaging his work.
You know, there's another lesser discussed technological factor, which I think may have been involved as well. Back then, Channel 13 was what was called a VHF signal.
Right.
Stations that were number 2 through 13 had very strong signals. But even with a strong signal, I remember we lived in New Haven, Connecticut, we could never watch Seoul because the signal did not reach New Haven, period. There was only a ghost-like image. It was impossible to watch. And this is before cable. Before satellite. And some local public television networks had what they call UHF signals, which were much weaker, and you had to have a different television and a different antenna. So I don't think that Seoul had the national carriage that would have given it the clout it would have been necessary to help prevail in that battle as well. So I think there were several handicaps, some political, some organizational, and some just technological, that were sure. difficult to surmount. But you can't underestimate
some programmatic as well, because even though it was in like 14 of the major markets across the country, it was always the choice of the station,
right. whether to carry it.
So they would get the tape, and they would call it bicycling around the tapes. They would have the tape, but whether they actually played it, and if they played it at a time when it could be watched, that was the choice of that station.
And but so we can't underestimate that Nixon really had it in for this program.
True.
Quite explicitly. And
it makes a very great
put a lot of pressure. Other questions, if we have time?
Yeah.
There was a question.
We have another question. This one comes from Alan Swartz. Thank you both very much. The original program was kind of a revelation for many, it seems to me. Does it seem now that we need something that unfolds into discussion more, maybe with episodes from the original program supporting follow-ups of different kinds?
Melissa.
I love that idea. And I'm actually in talks with several creatives about how to use this archive in a new way to inspire and create conversation opportunities, and for just another workout of the archive. I think that we need something like Soul. We definitely need Soul. We also need to see the original episodes. It's really sad that it was made for public television for us, but it's not accessible to us. So I would like to see both things happen. I'd like to see a reissuing of Soul. And I hope that with the notice that we're getting for the film and the interest that it's creating in the series, that will reinvigorate the opportunity to maybe even release a best of or a box set.
Interesting.
And at the same time, maybe we can pick up the mantle and create a new Soul that would be commensurate with what the issues are today and how the artists are navigating in that world.
Mm-hmm. Great thought.
All right, we have time for one last question. This one is sort of a comment/question from Beth Verholt. She would like to know, Melissa, if you could speak about the editing, as it was amazing on a whole, and she really loved how it was all put together.
Oh, thank you so much. The editing was an incredible challenge, and we had several editors. We actually had three full-time editors, and sometimes each editor had an incredible skill that we recognized early. One editor was really good at shaping character, and she saw the through lines of all the main characters, including the character of music, because I said I need the music to really be a character, not just background, but we need to see the evolution of the music as well as part of the journey of African Americans. And then we had another editor who was really good at taking, putting together these audio and oral and visceral, almost like montages, where you could have 3, 4, or 5, sometimes elements, and sometimes 10 stacked up on the timeline that would bring together both the storytelling that you're seeing and hearing, much like the way we are able to sort of assimilate a lot of different things at once, whether it's how we multitask today on our devices and are on the phone and we're on, you know, social media and we're also on a call, we're also on Zoom. Well, we thought, can we make those demands of our audience such that we can layer and add so much depth and nuance to the material that we're showing? Can we work it out in a way that you don't expect? That was another goal of ours, was to approach the archive differently and find ways to illuminate elements of it. So sometimes you would be hearing the audio from one clip, but you would be seeing another clip, and you'd also be hearing a contemporary interview overlaid onto that, but you might be looking at a Soul performance. And so we were trying to bring in all these elements at once. And as I said, the difficult thing was, in terms of the editing, is that we literally edited three films. So the three storylines. We edited the story of Soul, because that's 130 episodes, and pulling all the best performances and the most salient conversations that illustrated the show and the story we're telling. And then we had to have the story of Ellis Haizlip, not from cradle to grave, but the 5 years that lined up from 68 to 73. And you have to understand his backstory and how he brought that his unique stamp to Seoul, and maybe a little bit of what happened afterwards. And then you had the third storyline, which is the zeitgeist, as I said earlier, this notion of what was happening in the country that would have created an opportunity for Seoul to exist. And the hard part for our editors was to collapse those three stories. That was really a challenge. But we knew that what we were doing was hybrid and different. And whenever I tried to explain that to somebody, they would say, well, is it a biography? Is it a clip show? Is it, you know, clips and heads? It's like, no, we are weaving together various elements, and we believe that each one relies upon the other and speaks to the other. And so it was really very hard, but literally we had an editor who would come in from literally 10 to 6 every day. Then we had a night editor who would work with me from 6 to 10.
Wow.
And then I had another editor who would come in and advise me from sometimes 10 to 2 or 3 in the morning. And then we'd get up and do it again the next day.
Wow.
But we had all of our sights on telling this story in a unique way. And remember, here we are in 2020, and we've been shooting since 2009. And so we've gone through all the various technologies and the different cameras you can use as well. And to know that we want to tell the story ultimately in a very contemporary way, shooting in 4K, 5K, oops, fifth camera. And that was important. Like, how do we weave together all of these elements, these clunky tapes from 1968 and this high, overly high-res digital content that we're shooting on with our red cameras. So we realized we had to pull it all together, and I decided to create sort of like a unifying graphic aesthetic that would help seam it together. And that also was a biographical element. It was Ellis Haizlip being the storyteller. And we used these vignettes to sort of tie it all in together and to help with those
transitions.
Also, sound design was really key to put you in the space and to help transition from, say, his life growing up in the 1940s to the present day for him. And then, of course, the music tied it all together with our composer, Robert Glasper, who is an amazing performer and writer and musician. And that music had to tie it all in, even though we were featuring these extraordinary performances from Seoul. We also had to have sort of a sonic bed and themes. We had an Ellis theme. We had the Nixon theme. I called it, I said, well, he's the nemesis. And I said something like Jaws. And so we'll call it the Jixon. We called it Jixon because it was a Jaws sort of scary underbelly kind of wonderful theme, but he needed his theme. Every nemesis, every villain needs a theme. So we had themes throughout, and the one theme, the underlying theme, was the theme of Show Me Your Soul, which is a song you hear in the end. And we broke that down throughout the film as Ellis's theme. And we also had themes that brought you into the interiority of his thought. So everything was very, very deliberate. We looked at every aspect of storytelling, and is it coming across visually? Is it coming across orally? Is it coming across digitally? These were all questions that we asked ourselves over and over and over. We were relentless with that.
Melissa, my cousin Melissa, we're incredibly proud of you, and thank you for that journey into the making of Mr. Seoul. And let me also thank everyone who joined us. This has been a wonderful conversation, and I'm sure we're all in the cheering section for you to get an Oscar nomination and an Oscar. Thank you.
I'm grateful to get this film out. And thank you to our hosts, especially the Jacob Burns Film Center, for streaming the film and being one of our streaming partners and helping put us out. Thank you so much.
Okay. Good night, everyone.
Good night, everybody. Bye. Thank you, Hugh and Melissa. Great conversation. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.